Right now, there are hundreds of virtual tour platforms out there that can make stunning 360 tours for every type of use case. The problem is, not one of these platforms offer a free option that is genuinely free and usable over a long period of time, forcing beginners and occasional virtual tour creators to invest in monthly and yearly subscriptions for software they'll rarely use. While many platforms have quote-unquote free options, this usually involves either a limited free trial period, or a stripped back version of the software with limited features or publishing options that don't go beyond a couple of tours. But today, that changes, because I've just discovered a virtual tour platform that has a lot of the same features as the other beginner to intermediate softwares without the price tag. Now, this is a video that I'm adding to my Virtual Tour Pro course, but also sharing with you guys on YouTube for free as a taste of what you'll find inside the full course. If you get value from this video and it saves you hundreds of dollars of subscription fees, then that money is going to be so much better spent investing in the knowledge you need to create your very own virtual tour business that actually pays you for every single shoot. You can learn more by following the link below. And drumroll, the platform I'm going to be sharing with you today is called Panoi. Panoi, something like that. And this software can be used completely for free. As you see here in their free package, you can upload unlimited tours with up to 3 gigabytes of storage, which is actually a decent amount. I calculated it, and it adds up to roughly 150 photos if you're using a point and shoot 360 camera, which is so much more than the other platforms allow. And it has some other useful things here again in their free package. Now, Panoi isn't a new platform. It has been around for a year or two, but it's very much a hidden gem. You don't hear a lot of people talking about it. So if you're just getting started with virtual tours, or you're already into virtual tours and wanting to migrate to a different platform that doesn't charge you monthly fees, then you'll definitely want to pay close attention. And yes, they do have bigger packages, but these won't be necessary until you're shooting tours at serious volume. So it's pretty easy to get started with Panoi. All you need to do is click Get Started Free, then create an account, which will take a minute. Once you've done that, it will take you through to your dashboard, which is where you can start a new project. It may prompt you to do this straight up. Now, they may automatically give you a free 14-day trial to their pro subscription. As you can see here with mine, I've got 13 days to go, but don't worry, almost every feature I'm going to show you in this video will only use the features found in the free version. So to start a new project, I'm going to go up to new project here. I'm going to give my project a name as well as a description. And then there's category. It doesn't really matter which one you pick here. If you're not sure, just click others and let's go. Now you'd be prompted to upload photos. And as you can see, I've got a few here that I uploaded on a previous project, but to upload your own photos, hover over upload 360 image and then click 360 image. Find your shots, select them and click open, and it will upload them in a minute or two. These shots were taken with my X5, which I've already stitched and exported in Insta360 Studio. All right, now that that's done, I'm going to select the images I want to include in this new virtual tour. I'm going to keep this one simple and use 2 photos only, and now submit. And now Panoi has created our virtual tour. The interface is pretty similar to most other virtual tour platforms, where you have a big interactive window in the middle. You've got your various settings on the right and left. Hotspots and media are found down the bottom, and up the top is where you progress through the various stages of editing your virtual tour. Don't worry, I know this looks intimidating, but we're only going to be using a few of these. Now, firstly, to view your photos, you can zoom in and out with your mouse to see them from a wider or closer in perspective. And once you've chosen one that you're happy with, that you want to be the default view of each shot, down here in blue, you'll want to click Save Default View. As you can see, it's updated here on the thumbnail. So anytime someone clicks into this shot, it's going to point in this direction. Before I go too far, I'm just going to rename these shots so they're not named image with a whole bunch of numbers. To connect up these 2 photos, it's really simple. All you need to do is grab the photo that you want to be the hotspot. So I can see the balconies out here. So I'm going to click and drag this one. And when I let it go, you'll see that it's automatically created a hotspot out here, which I can click and drag to adjust. Likewise with my other photo, when I click through and point the angle back, I want a hotspot to be here. So I'm going to click and drag this hotspot into the gap. You may need to rename these again, which will take a second. If your hotspot shows up with a label like this, you can also rename it here on the right-hand side. So I'm going to put in office, and there we go. If you want to delete this hotspot, all you need to do is click delete and then submit, and it's gone, but I'm going to keep it there. Now, something I'm definitely impressed with PanOE is you can customize these hotspots with a pretty good degree of control. Here's what I mean. So I've got office selected here, and you can actually change the look of this hotspot in a couple of ways. Firstly, you can use an icon, and it's got a drop-down menu for different types of icon you might want to use. You can use an image, so this is more of a traditional virtual tour style. Next to that is Lottie, which refers to like animated sticker things, which won't be a good option. Then there's callout, which will add a line to the hotspot. But the one I like the most is marker. So if we click that, you'll see that it's given us a little preview here at the top. And if we click apply, it will override the hotspot design. So this is like a location marker, but it's also got a little sphere in the middle showing what's inside this photo. You can also change the size of these hotspots. So I'm going to make this one a little bit bigger. I'll go up to 4. This will be a bit of a guessing game. There aren't any sliders. So if you just like put in a number, you'll see that here in the preview window, it's going to show us what it looks like. You can just click apply to see it. And yeah, that definitely looks a bit too big. So I'm going to scale this one down to size 4, then click apply again. And yeah, I like the size of this hotspot. I'm just going to change the location of it to be a bit higher here. And now this hotspot will stay in the exact same spot as we move our 360 image around. Underneath the hotspots, you'll also see there's a transition option. If you want to create an animated transition between your shots, there are a whole bunch of options to choose from here. Some of these will look good and some not. So definitely give them a go to see if any appeal to you. This one here, Zoom Blend, was definitely not bad. And finally, at the bottom of this menu, you can find a few different options that influence what shows up in the circle of your hotspot. It can either be like the equirectangular shot squished into a circle. It can be the thumbnail that is set here, or it can be something else that you upload. By the way, you don't need to save your tour as you're editing it. It will be done automatically. So now my first photo, what I'm going to do is replicate the look of the hotspot so we have consistency. Now I'll adjust its position, and that is looking great. At any point, if you want to preview your tour as you're editing, all you need to do is press this play button at the top right to preview. This will open it up in a new window, and now we can see what the tour looks like if it were published. I'll click through to the balcony, and that worked pretty well. So that's not a bad first edit, but I can see it definitely needs some tweaks. What I didn't like is when I click through, the camera faced slightly to the left, and with my hotspot selected, I can see here on the right-hand side that the initial orientation for the click-through was angled slightly to the left. So I'm going to adjust that and now set target view. So now when we click through from one to the other, we'll be facing in the same direction. The other thing I wanted to change, so if you click on a photo on the left-hand side, you'll notice here on the right, there's a whole bunch of things we can adjust that have to do specifically with the photo. And the one that I want to change is the field of view. Now with virtual tours, you've got to be careful not to let people zoom out too far, because that's when tours look really distorted and quite fisheye. And on the flip side, you don't want them to zoom in too far, because this can draw attention to low quality. And this is pretty easy to do here under the view tab. This is where you can set directional limits on your photos. So if you want to limit the view, like how far people can look up and down, you can do that, as well as left and right. But you won't want to do that because a 360 is supposed to be a 360 and people should be able to look all the way around. But what I want to do is limit the zoom both in and out. So firstly, I'm going to reduce how zoomed in people can go. I'm going to change that from 150 to 120. And to apply that, just click the tick, which saves it. As well as on the other end, I'm going to change 60 to around 90, and I'll click save. So now when we preview our shot again, as I zoom in, the zoom wheel almost stops as I go in and out, stopping me from going too wide or too close. Now, whenever you perform a specific action on a photo, it's always a good idea to perform that same action on the others for the sake of consistency. And you don't want to do everything at once and then hope you remember on the next photo to do that same sequence of things. Instead, make sure you do it at the same time. So I'm going to go to the balcony here and adjust the parameters. Now, there are a whole bunch of customization options on this same menu new page. So if you want to set the thumbnail, this is what appears at the bottom of the virtual tour in the thumbnail gallery. All you need to do is choose your perspective and click make screenshot. And as you can see in the final tour, this has been updated. Underneath that, you can replace the photo. If you say re-edited your photo with different colors, you can easily just swap it in here, as well as adding new photos here on the left-hand side. You can add an article, which is essentially like a pop-up text box. Here's something simple. Then I'm just going to select that here. And on the right hand side, this will show up as an iBox. So this is basically like a little info tab. You can add a music track to your clip if you want some ambient sound. There are some pretty cool ones here. You can stage your shot if you want to import a PNG and place stuff around the shot. They've also got a day to dusk feature. So this is if you take the exact same photo at two different times of day, you can transition from one to the other over a set period of time. That's a bit advanced though, so let's stay away from it for now. There's filter processing. This is like color correction, and again, there's no sliders here, so don't use this unless you're desperate and just need to add a bit to your exposure. As you can see, I way overdid it, but these commands do work in zero decimal, so you could go like 0.2. And as you can see, it just lightened the shot a tiny bit. So be my guest, if you do want to color correct, then go for it. But I would always recommend you do it elsewhere, like in Insta360 Studio using its inbuilt color correction menu. There's also a sharpen filter if you want to sharpen, but I never recommend that for 360 photos since it almost always looks over sharpened. Under that is a sunlight filter. Here is where you can add a natural looking lens flare. And this one can look really good in the right scenario, like this outdoor shot where there was legitimately sunlight poking through the trees, but in everyday settings you'll want to keep this one off. Now in this bottom menu there are a whole bunch of other things you can add to your tour. It doesn't just have to be hotspots directing your viewer from one shot to another, but you can also add other forms of media, like an image. If you click and drag that, here we can now add an image. This will set up this hotspot so it acts like a button, and when people click it, your image will pop up. So I'm going to give it a name and change the look of it. I'll give it this information icon and click apply and move it around here. Now when we preview this, I'm going to look across. It says LUT pack. And voila, there's my image. The other types of hotspot here are very similar in premise to what I just showed you. You can also add a video, a link to a website, a news article, and you get the gist. To delete anything, it's pretty simple. Just click it and then click delete. But what if, say, you wanted something to show up within the actual 360 photo without having to click it first? Well, that's where this media section comes in. So here you can add a video, a photo, text, or a live chat option. And when we click and drag that across, you'll see that it's added a text box here. So if we double click it, on the right hand side, we can click edit text. And here we can add this text. I'm just going to select it, change the font color to black, and click submit. So you'll see it's right here. So I can click and drag it around my 360 image. So let's say I wanted it here in this white space. There we go. And when I preview it, there's my text. There's also a polygon option, but that's getting a bit advanced, so I won't cover that in this video. All right, this tour is looking really good. So I think we're ready to add the finishing touches. So I'm gonna go up the top, and on the very left is the tour editor, which is where we've just edited this tour. If you click across, here you can see a visual representation of our tour, which is really cool. Most softwares don't have a feature like this. So if you've got lots of photos, you'll be able to visually map out your tour. Then there's Google Street View, but don't worry about that because that's a paid feature and probably not needed at this point. Then there's design, and this has to do with the interface of the virtual tour. So here we can change the style of menus. So previously I had thumbnails at the bottom, but let's say you want them on the side. Here you can change that orientation as well as adjust the colors. I want that in red and white. And as you'll see, it's created this cool little menu. And you can also change the fonts and a few other things in here. Keep in mind that a lot of these are paid features like Dollhouse, Google Maps, floor plans, and so on. So I wouldn't spend too much time on this page other than the theme. So the next menu you want to navigate to before we publish this tour is setting. And here is where we can change a few settings to do with the tour. I don't know if you noticed, but there was a little logo down here that says created with Panoe. You can either turn that off here on this page, or customize it, like so. And this will reflect in the bottom left corner of your tour. On this page, there's also an option to add a custom nader. So if you go set image and choose your logo, so I just made a really simple logo in Canva that is a circular PNG with a clear background. So when I click submit, that's now added this as my nader. So now when I go back to previewing the tour, there we go, it's my logo and it moves with the movement of the 360. The size of this can also be customized in the same way as before. So if you want it smaller, just go down a little bit to like 0.7. And now you'll see that it's shrunk down to a smaller size. This is not compulsory, however. So if you don't want a logo there, then you'll want to disable nader. Most other features you want to leave because a lot of them are paid features. There's a few more things here under effect, like auto rotate and some other settings that have to do with the viewing of the 360 when people are navigating your tour. And the other ones here are paid features. So I'm going to leave those ones for now. All right, well, we've made our tour and it's time to publish. So to do that, click the publish button here on the right hand side. And how good is this? While you can't get a custom domain for free on the free Panoe account, you can get a free custom subdomain. So here I could change this to Ben's office, and my domain for this tour is now going to be tour.panoe.net/Ben's office. In this menu, you'll also find some other custom URL settings. Again, you will need to pay for some of these for more advanced customization. So let's leave that for now. Instead, we're going to go up to the top right and click the yellow button, publish, and then set public. And this will now set our tour to public. So now our tour is live and we can share the URL with anyone we want. And there you have it. There's Panoe in a nutshell. Look, it's not the fanciest virtual tour software out there, but for a free platform, this is more than capable of producing tours that you could absolutely charge for small to medium sized businesses. And it's just so good that you don't have to pay for the free tier of this platform, which means you could make say 10 to 15 tours with the 3 GB allocation. And if you wanted to make more, you could either just delete the tours that you've got, or you'll notice on their pricing page, you can buy extra data for, get this, 15 cents per gigabyte per month. Other platforms would charge way more than this, but 15 cents a month per gigabyte is absolutely affordable. And it's a la carte. You don't have to buy 100 gigabytes at a time or unlimited. You can just buy an extra 1 GB if you want. So I see Panoe as a great platform for beginner virtual tour creators to start with. So you don't have to invest too much with your initial virtual tour creation. You might be someone who's just dabbling and you want to try it out to see how you like it. Well, this is exactly what Panoe excels at being a very good beginner platform that has practically all the features a beginner virtual tour photographer would need. It's not a one-size-fits-all solution if you're getting more advanced and shooting a lot more tours, or you need more capabilities like a really good dollhouse or a lot more customization of your branding. You'll still want to consider other platforms such as 3D Vista, Cooler, Teleport Me. There's so many great options out there, but I'd only upgrade to a paid subscription, including of Panoe, once you're actually making money with your tours. And if you want to learn how to do that, inside my virtual tour pro course, I take you by the hand and show you step by step how to create stunning virtual tours that you can charge for, as well as how to find businesses that will actually pay you for them and exactly what to say to them to win them over as a paid client. If you follow the course step by step, you'll make back the entire course cost with your very first paid tour. So if that sounds too good to be true, then feel free to follow the link below to learn more. And if you own an Insta360 camera and you're not sure which settings to use for virtual tours, in this video here, I share all of the best settings that I use that are surprisingly simple yet extremely powerful.